Hey all, welcome to the subject of network theory. This course is a course which we are running for second year EXTC. The basic requirements of this course is a good knowledge of BEE, basic electrical engineering, which you have studied in your FE, plus mathematics, which you have done in your first year. A combination of both these things will help you to achieve a good score in the subject of network theory. One basic important fact of this subject is that however you try and solve a sum, there is always going to be one more method more which you can solve the sum through. So understanding all the methods and choosing the best method is what is going to drive your success quotient. Fine. So to achieve all of this, the most important part is practice. Practice, practice, and practice more. Fine. There is basically no theory in this course. You are not going to be asked any theory questions. So no theory. You will only have sums, okay, or problems. So I consider this to be a good thing because you have no theory. No theory means there is no memorization required. You directly have your concept of your sums ready and you can solve your sums. So only sums and no theory, and that is the best part of this subject. Be rest assured that if you follow all the videos and all the classroom material, you are surely going to achieve good marks in your examination. I'll be covering each and every module and you just have to sit through all of these modules, see and understand the method in which I solve sums and then go forward and solve sums yourselves. Okay. So before we start any course, it is very important to have a bird's eye view. Okay, I call this as the bird's eye view of the syllabus. Okay, so you must always look from a top-down approach, understand what all things you have to study, and then attack each module. Fine. So the first thing is basics. Okay, the basics, whatever has to be learned. Then you have theorems that have to be learned. Then you have AC analysis, then you have transients, and then you have some miscellaneous. Alright, out of these things, you have done many parts of the portion in your first year. For example, if I talk about basics, so basics, you have basis of what is RLC. Then you have passive and active elements. Then you know what are sources. Okay, so you know what are independent sources. In this subject, we learn what is called as dependent sources. That is a new thing to be learned. You know your most important Ohm's law. You know your KCL. You know your KVL. Then you know mesh analysis. And you know nodal. Fine. So what do you understand by mesh? We'll learn it when we are actually approaching it. Mesh means Ohm's law plus KVL. What is nodal? Again, Ohm's law plus KCL. Fine. Then also you have learned what is star delta, and you have also seen what is source transformation. So all these things we are going to repeat again in this subject. Alright. So we are going to attack all these sums by understanding the basic concepts. We'll go through all these concepts once again when we are starting off with the syllabus. And then we'll solve sums mainly of dependent sources. This is the new thing which you are going to study in this basics. Now theorems remains the same as you have learned last time in your first year. That is SPT, superposition theorem. Then you have Thevenin's. Then you have Norton's, then you have reciprocity theorem, and duality theorem. Okay. This is what you are going to study. Out of this, majorly you have seen SPT, Thevenin's, and Norton's in the first year, and you will be continuing with these theorems also. Now, AC analysis is what you have already seen in your first year. We are not going to go into this. So, in AC analysis, you have your phasors, you have RLC, RLC, then you have RL, RC, RLC in series and parallel. Then you have seen resonance. Okay, so all these things we are not going to cover in network theory. What we're going to see over here is a new thing called as graph theory. All right. Now transients. Okay, transients is something entirely new. So I'll put this entire thing in red. So this is an entire new thing. So what have we understood? Out of basics, we need to study something called as dependent sources, which is new. Here you need to study graph theory, which is new, and transients is an entirely new thing. Okay, inside transients you have your DC transients. Okay, so you have something called as source free circuits. Okay, then with DC sources, and then the Laplace transform approach. Okay, don't worry about any of this, we are just noting things down so that we know what is to be done. Then you have AC analysis, and then you have something called as network functions. Okay, network functions. Inside miscellaneous, I will add one more extra thing over here called as network synthesis. Okay, and then we'll see something called as two port networks. Okay, you can note this down and keep. So if I now go module wise, you'll understand that this takes care of your module one. Okay, this entire thing, the basics plus theorems, they take care of your module one. Okay, basically you will have your theorems, and then you will have something new called as dependent source, that is module one. Then module two is your graph theory. All right. Module three is your transients. Network functions is your module 4. Then you have something called as two port networks, which become module 5, and you have network synthesis, which become module 6. So in all you have 6 modules to take care of. Fine. So a person who has understanding of all these modules will be able to solve all the sums in his examination. So as you all know, the scheme of this subject is network theory scheme is, you have 80 marks of theory and 20 marks of internal examinations. So you have IA exams, and you have something called as N semester exams, and you have 25 marks of term work. All right. So in total, you have 125 marks for the subject. This is according to the new revision C. Okay, revision C 2019 syllabus scheme. Okay, so please note this down and keep that we are now currently, as of July 2020, we are going to start off with the revision C 2019 scheme. So term work is obtained by means of tutorials. Okay, so you will have tutorial sessions of 2 hours per week, and solving tutorial questions will help you to fetch this 25 marks. Fine. For your theory, you will have 3 lectures per week. You will have 3 lectures per week. So in total, a student will be exposed to 5 hours per week. Okay. So in this 5 hours, you will need to learn and achieve all the things that are required. Let us start off this course by just revising whatever we have learned in our first year. Fine. Let us start off with the most basic thing. Okay. So I have network theory, that is my course. The most basic question is, what is the difference between a circuit and a network? Fine. The most simplest of definitions or understanding is, network is like a building. A building has many houses, house 1, house 2, house 3, house 4, house 5, house 6. And the analogy of this for a circuit is just this one house. So an individual house is a circuit and a collection of houses is a network. So when we see this in terms of electrical engineering, what we'll say is that a circuit is just one loop. Okay, for example, I have this R and L. This is one loop. So this is a circuit. If I have many loops like this, so circuit 1, circuit 2, this becomes my network. Fine. Don't be afraid of R, L and C's. Okay, if you have any worries about AC circuits, please keep it away for the moment. We are going to start off with only DC. So don't worry about R, L and C. We will cross that when we actually reach it. Right. So I hope you are clear with what is circuit and what is networks. Next, let us understand what is R, L and C. So I am going to just basically brief you on all these things, R, L and C's. Since you have already learned this in your first year, so we will not go into depth. Okay. So what is R, L and C's? Okay. Any element, okay, any element that opposes the free movement of electrons. Okay. So those elements are categorized into three components for us, which are R, L and C's. So R, L and C's are any components that oppose, okay, these things oppose the free movement of electron are called as RLNCs. Opposing free movement of electron means opposing the free movement of electric current. In electrical engineering, we approximate all these things as lump circuits called as R, L and C, resistors, inductors and capacitors. So the resistance given by resistor is given in terms of ohms. The resistance given by inductor is given in terms of Henry, and the resistance given in terms of capacitance is given as farads. Okay, so ohm, Henry and farads. So earlier we have seen what is circuit and network bifurcation. Now we have seen what is R, L and C's. Let us now understand what is charge. So basically there are two kinds of charges. One is positive and negative. There is charge from a proton and charge from an electron. In electrical engineering, we are basically worried about electron charge. So we all know, right, that coulombs is the unit of charge. So I can say, right, one electron is equal to minus 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb. Okay. So what is the meaning of this? This is the charge of an electron, that is minus 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulombs. So what is going to be coulombs then? One coulomb. So if I just cross multiply, what is 1 coulomb? 1 coulomb is going to give me 0.625 into 10 raised to 19 electrons. Okay. So what I can say that 1 coulomb of charge, it corresponds to 0.625 into 10 raised to 19 electrons moving. So if in a wire, I understand that there are going to be 0.625 into 10 raised to 19 electrons moving, I will say that my charge is 1 coulombs. I will say that my charge is 1 coulombs. Okay. So the unit of charge is coulombs. And what is the meaning of a coulomb? 1 coulomb of charge means 0.625 into 10 raised to 19 electrons moving. So then what is current then? Okay. Then we will see, if you have understood what is coulomb, we will see what is current. Okay, so current means all these electrons or all this charge that is moving or in motion is called as a current. So we define current as all the electrons that is all these charges that pass through a wire for a particular period of time, and that time we'll say maybe in seconds. So if I talk about 1 ampere, okay, 1 ampere, 1 ampere means 1 coulomb of charge passing through a wire for 1 second. So I'm saying 1 coulomb of charge passing through a wire for 1 second is called as 1 ampere of current. So what is the meaning of that? If I have a wire like this and I say that 0.625 into 10 raised to 19 electrons move across the cross reference, cross section of this wire for 1 second, then it is called as 1 ampere of current. Fine. So 1 ampere we say is 1 coulomb which passes for 1 second. Understanding currents is very important for electrical engineer. You must exactly understand what is current. Current means a movement or a flow of electrons for some amount of time is called as current, and the unit of current is amperes. Fine. So unit of current is amperes, and what do we say? We say that 1 ampere is 1 coulomb of charge that passes through a cross section of a wire for 1 second. Next, let us understand the R in RLC. Okay, so you have learned in your first year resistance R is equal to rho L by A. Imagine I have a resistor, the symbol is like this. Okay, it is 100 ohms and 1 by 4 watt, and I have one more resistor of 100 ohms and of 2 watts. Now, if you go to a market and you ask the shopkeeper, I want a resistor, he will first ask you what is the resistance you want. So, he will say, okay, I want a 100 ohm resistance. Then he will ask you, what is the power rating that you want? So, then you should not be confused, or what do I require? So, then you must exactly know that for every resistor, there is a thing called as power rating. Okay. So, 1 by 4 watt is the power rating of this resistor. In the market, if you see it, it is going to be a very thin resistor like this. And if you tell them that give me a 2 watt resistor, then they are going to give you a big resistor like this, a fat resistor like this, which is going to be of 2 watts. Okay. So, what is the difference between this 1 by 4 watt and this 2 watts is what we will see now. So, for example, I have a 100 volt supply. Okay. And have a resistor like this of 100 ohms. What is the current that flows like this? Current is going to be 100 upon 100, that is 1 ampere. And what is the power across this 100 ohms? I squared R, right? What is I squared? 1 squared into R. R is 100, it is 100 watts. I have a resistor like this, which can take a power rating of 1 by 4 watts. Means if the power across the resistor goes more than 1 by 4 watt or 0.25 watts, then what is going to happen? The entire resistor is going to be smoked out. Fine. So, whenever you buy a resistor, you should be very careful of the amount of current that flows through this resistor. If the amount of current is like this of 1 ampere and you are going to pass it through a resistor of only 100 ohms, what is going to happen? 100 watt of power is going to come across that resistor. So, what is going to happen? Your entire resistor will be smoked off. Okay. Okay. So, this thing is what you need to avoid. So, whenever you are using a resistor, please be very careful that the amount of current that flows through the resistor is as per the power dissipation or power wattage of that resistor. Fine. So, if you have a 2 watt resistor, you can pass 2 watts of power through that. So, how do you feel this power? This 2 watt of power is felt across this resistor by means of heat or light. Okay. So, when you touch this resistor, you will find it to be hot. That means that there is some power that is getting dissipated across this resistor. Fine. So, if you touch any resistor, you will find some amount of heating. So, what you must do is, you must limit the amount of current that flows through that resistor. Okay. These all are parts of circuit designing. So, you should be very specific about what kind of components you are going to use. So wrapping up resistance, what we can say, resistance is rho L by A, where your rho is your resistivity. Okay, that is the ease at which electrons can flow through this entire material. L is the length of the material and A is the cross sectional area. Okay, so resistance unit is ohms. Okay, ohms. When we talk of resistance, we should also talk of conductivity. Conductance is given as G. G is equal to I by V, that is 1 by R. Okay, so inverse of resistance is conductivity, and the SI units of conductivity is mho or Siemens. So resistance, if you compare, resistance is R is equal to V by I, and the unit of this is ohms. We just go through inductance also once. Inductance. So we have seen inductance earlier. What is inductance? Inductance means anything which opposes the flow of current through a system is given in terms of three elements, that is R, L, and C, and one is inductance L. If I have an inductor, inductor is a coil which is wound in a circular fashion like this. Okay, so whenever a time varying current flows through this inductor, a time varying flux is getting generated over here. We will not go into this, we will just directly see what is the value of the voltage across the inductor L. So VL is given as L dIL by dt. Okay, you must remember this formula very well. Similarly, what is IL then? IL of t. IL of t you will say as 1 by L integration VL of t dt, and you will give this as minus infinity to t. You are going to measure the current from start till that point t. And if I talk of capacitance, I have a capacitance like this. There is some voltage across the capacitor Vc. If I talk of Ic of t, that is the voltage across the capacitor, I will say it as C dVc by dt. And for what is Vc? Vc of t. Vc of t is 1 by C integration minus infinity Ict dt. Fine. So you just have to remember these two formulae, 1 and 2. And then you can deduce IL of t from VL of t. You can deduce VC of t from IC of t. So we'll stop this topic by understanding at the end Ohm's law, most important law for electrical engineers. Okay, we have seen this formula, current density is equal to sigma E, where sigma is given as your conductivity. E is your electric field and J is your current density. So J bar comes out to be I by A, okay, current density, okay, how much current is flowing through an area. Sigma, electric field, is given as V by L. So you can say therefore I is equal to sigma A by L V. Therefore, V is equal to 1 by sigma L by A into I. So sigma is your conductivity. What is 1 by sigma? It is going to be your resistivity, that is rho. So sigma is your conductivity and rho is your resistivity. And rho is equal to 1 by sigma. So you can say rho L by A into I. Alright. And what have we said this rho L by I, rho L by A as? It is a resistance R I V. Therefore, V is equal to I R is your Ohm's law. Fine. So Ohm's law is not just limited to resistance, right? So as we have seen, for resistance, if we say Ohm's law is V is equal to I into R. If I talk about inductor, what is the Ohm's law over here? Ohm's law is V L is equal to L dIL by dt, and C is VC 1 by C integration IC dt minus infinity to t. Fine. So all these are different types of Ohm's law. So Ohm's law is not just V is equal to IR. Ohm's law is all these three things together, and that is your Ohm's law. Fine. So the different types of Ohm's law is this one for a resistor, this one for an inductor, and this one for a capacitor. Fine. So by means of this understanding of R, L, and C's, I think we can go forward and achieve what we want from this course.